Today I'm going to start a sequence on large-scale adaptations. We've already looked at certain kinds of adaptations that resulted from macroevolution that produced traits that enhanced survival through improved vision, like eyes, or improved insulation and then flight, such as feathers. But today I'm going to look at some fundamental processes that can even reduce survival. And the first topic we'll look at is called sexual selection. And this involves behaviors and physical characteristics that have to do with mating. Next, we'll look at the evolution of reproduction. Then we'll go on to look at cooperation, why some diseases are nastier to you than others, so we look at the virulence of disease. And then we'll look at why it is that our cells seem programmed to die and why it is we grow old. Now, we've already seen how natural selection produces adaptations. And we think about these adaptations generally as enhancing abilities to catch food. So the cheetah is the fastest land animal, so it can run down its very fleet-footed prey. To avoid predation, so the camouflage of the stick insect makes it harder for the bird to see it. And insulation in the polar bear allows it to survive very harsh weather. But what about traits like this? Why should the Irish elk have gone around with this ridiculously large hat on its head? And peacocks with their extraordinary tails, goofy displays, and the lion's mane. I mean, sure, he looks kind of nice with that mane, but why is he wearing a very heavy sweater in a hot climate? And behaviors too. We see animals like this crab who have these very stylized displays out in the open that would make them much easier for predators to spot. And why is it that in all of these cases, the male deer, the male lion, the male crab, it's the males that are so extravagant and even extravagantly colored, like this mallard duck with its bright green head compared to the rather drab female, or this absurdly colored mandrill, a monkey that lives in the rainforest of West Africa, with a bright red and blue face, next to a more sensibly colored female who blends in the darkness of the jungle. Now, if we think about fitness, which we've described as the ability to transmit genes to the next generation, we have to keep in mind that fitness actually has two basic components. First is survival, so that's why we have good vision and birds have feathers. But it's also essential to keep in mind reproduction. Sexual selection is focused entirely on that process of reproduction, and Darwin recognized the importance of selection for traits that contribute to reproductive advantage rather than to survival. And in some cases, this reproductive advantage may even come at the cost of survival. Now, to begin with, we want to start at the very beginning. We're assuming that there are such things as males and females, and they're different from each other. But why are males and females so different? Well, this is a simple cartoon that imagines there's two different individuals that are producing gametes. And the gametes of each individual might be about the same size. They could then fuse together and form a zygote. So this is now a diploid zygote ready to go through mitosis and become a new individual. So if we imagine that we had in some sort of ancestral population where everybody had gametes about the same size, and we imagine that it was normally distributed, so as a quantitative trait, most gametes would be in this average. There might be a few exceptionally large gametes, and there might be a few exceptionally small ones. Now, if we had this setup, if we had intermediate size gametes, these are going to take up a fair amount of resources to produce. And so there might be a limit as to how much our organism can produce. But if it happens to be fertilized by a very small gamete, the amount of resources that it's bringing itself wouldn't be enough. If we have very, very small gametes, well, you know, they can never survive on their own and with merging with each other, but they have the advantage that they can be produced in massive numbers. So for a certain volume of resources going into the production of gametes, you can make a ton of very small ones. At the other end, if you have very large gametes, these could safely develop even if they were fertilized by a very, very tiny gamete, okay? But they're rather expensive to produce, okay? So if we have this basic setup and two different gametes have to come together to form a new offspring, we've actually described a situation that would be subject to what's called disruptive selection, and this would be based on gamete size. That the very small ones have an advantage because they can be produced in very large numbers, and the larger gametes have the advantage that it doesn't matter what they're fertilized by, they can always sustain the embryo. Okay? And so these would tend to persist in the population, as would these, as the intermediate ones disappeared. And I've just described for you the fundamental difference between males with very small gametes, whether it's sperm or pollen, and females, eggs or ova, few large gametes versus many small gametes. So this is actually the origins of what's called, in a very ugly term, anisogamy. Gamy as for the gametes, and aniso means they're not the same. So gametes of different size. A big egg here, and there'll just be one sperm that goes through and fertilizes it, although the male produced large numbers of sperm to get there. So, what we want to take away from this fundamental difference between males and females is that female reproduction is limited by the amount of resources that she can turn into eggs or young. Each one of her eggs is relatively expensive to produce. And that's extremely obvious when you think about birds. This is a single cell. This ostrich egg is a single cell, the gamete, and it's been fertilized. There's one little male sperm in there to restore the diploid state to the offspring. But this is a huge investment that the female is removing from her own body large amounts of nutrition. Okay? And so a single ostrich egg is about the equivalent of two dozen hen's eggs. In mammals, the eggs may not be that very large, but there's internal fertilization. And once the egg has been fertilized, the female diverts resources from her own maintenance to the growth of her fetus. And by the time the child is born, a lot of her resources have gone into that offspring. Now, in contrast to the females, the male reproduction is limited by the number of matings he can obtain. Females have to put all their energy into each egg, each baby as it comes along, but the males can now have a lot of energy left over for looking for more mates. And so we see in all kinds of different animals that males compete and behave rather crazily to get access to more and more females, whether they're tortoises, hyenas, or various different kinds of ungulates. So, sexual selection, the process whereby we get our genes into the next generation through traits that enhance our reproductive success, results in profound differences between males and females.